troubles.
Okay.
So what we want to do is to find an isomorphic and interpret it as a gluing function. So what is the map going to be? I already started doing this. So I'm making a notational, I'm making use of notation. So should perhaps be clear, given two perfect algebras, what it means to have a homomorphic from one to another. So I need a map that sends V to F of V. I will, for notational purposes, you'll see why, I will, instead of defining this, informally speaking, tell you where fields go. So I will be saying something like, let us make V of Z go to some other field that I will denote like that. The meaning of this notation, of course, is the obvious one. If I have F of Z, by this I mean V of Z is the sum. Like this, and by this I will simply mean F of V and V to the minus N minus 1. And of course, if I say this in particular, it means that I will tell you where the minus 1 goes. So saying this is saying more than we need. We need only this. But the field notation is simply more compact, as you will see in a second. So back to this. Well, this field here, where should it go? Well, we simply mimic the gluing functions on CP1. F goes to 1 and y. So the corresponding field will be y of the universe. And last time I spent quite some time explaining what that means. Where does dx go? This d is the same as dx. And that's where I stopped. We know the usual formula, which would be, you know, x squared twice or minus twice squared dy. An attempt to generalize it in the perfect situation is obvious. I will simply write the same formula in terms of fields. And since this thing has to be made sense of, I will, in a standard way, putting the normal order inside, meaning that this is like, dy. So, that's an attempt. Will it work?
But we said last time that it will not.
It will not, but you know, things change. Let's see. So what is it? What is it that we would like to check? We need at least to check that that the brackets are preserved.
And the inverse of y, can you just say in the...
That's a story. So 1 on x z is defined like this. So x of z, here I won't be using the bracket notation for the operation. This is a different system of notation that also standard because this thing is conformally graded. So this is also standard notation, but at the moment I'm not using any orthogonal field, almost none. So that's just like this. That's just
the
notation.
This is conformal weight zero.
Yeah, so this is conformal weight zero, hence without brackets notation is like this. With d, by the way, since Alberto is asking, d has conformal weight 1. And so there, the unbracketed notation coincides with this bracket. Anyway, so you divide by this field using Fagin's trick, as I explained, by separating the constant part and thinking of the rest as a small s. If so, you proceed just as we teach our calculus students. By the way, I remembered at night a nightmare, realizing that I wrote genetic some genetic sequence some wrong. So the result is, I think, that's what I missed. Oh. So that's the answer to Alberto's question. And then there was a series of exercises, very easy to do, that verify, this is a well-defined field, and it's local with x of z, d of z, and such. So by reconstruction theorem, you get a vertical distribution. As far as the module goes, this is a passage from the polynomial algebra to
because I that of z is local to z, is exponent 1, and here wasn't the exponent.
What do you mean by
z minus w to the power here? Say,
I don't get z minus w, what? didn't get it.
Locality means that if mouse were basing on a study to some power,
yes,
it kills it, right?
Power but, one. It's just like a function.
I second will be power.
Yeah. But what one of the, yes, actually this can be generalized to any function of x. Rational energy.
And every power one.
So the general formula, let me write it for you. That I told you this last time, but I will repeat. So you can take any funny function of x and define it similarly. And the bracket will be will have the following pleasing geometric nature. You will have to think of f as a function of x, as it is. So you differentiate f with respect to x, so you get f prime. You then make the substitution according to our rules. The bracket will be this thing times delta t minus one.
Excuse me? Do you need some non-ordering in that expansion?
No. They all commute with each other. That's why it easily works. I don't local. That probably has to do with our heated discussion in the morning. Localize. It's like d inverse. D inverse is hard to introduce. But
as well as you can, of course. I think Fourier coefficient must have.
We know with Mayuki that this can be done in more general situation, but then you have to pass to a kind of level, what was the name? Asymptotic plot itself, where you have to allow you have to introduce an extra form of parameter and allow infinite series. It's like going from differential operators to what they call asymptotic differential operators, things like that. So you can, but not in the situation
of infinite.
Yeah. So you will. If you are allowed to, right? But this is this has nothing to nothing to do with what kind of stuff. All right. Any other questions? So what is it that we want? Well, we want that the map preserves at least the commutators. So the commutators are, of course, there is a bunch of trivial ones. And the interesting one. By the way, this formula will work, but of course, this is much simpler. That's where we started. So this is given. So what we really want is that the same thing is valid for the image. So so x goes to 1 and z. Should be 0. And of course it is. Everything commutes there. Likewise, so next, y squared dy. This should be that. This is true immediately. More or less this form, but it's easier. That's an exercise. So this is true. And this is an exercise. It's a quick consequence of this formula. Roughly speaking, you will have to differentiate. You will get 1 and 1, 1 and y squared, which will cancel. It's a little harder than that things, you know, there is a double order, no ordering, but still there is no problem. So the fun begins when I verify this condition.
But there is no minus sign?
Ah, of course there is. Otherwise it will be false. And that's it's present over there.
Right.
So let's handle that.
But in my lecture, I will explain.
Yeah, and that will, I've thought about it, so I have mentioned all of them right now. So here is what we want to have. And the result is disappointingly, one might say, or perhaps intriguingly, is non-zero. Here it is. I'm cheating from my notes.
But wait, this sentence is when you write y squared divide of z, you probably have to put in parentheses, right? On the right, on the top. But you wrote everything. You should put y squared divide in parentheses on the right.
On the top?
To the right. No, very right.
Ah.
No, on the top.
It's y squared of z, dy of z.
Yeah, I meant. Yeah, I meant exactly
what you said. It means y of z, dy of z.
No, I think y squared divide should put in parentheses.
No, it's this expression, of course. Y of z.
Z.
This is due to the fact that I think of this as a field associated to more or less this element. A formula, I will have to write something like... Now, you will see why I like using the field notation. So the honest definition of the element would be y naught squared dy with coefficient minus 1, something like this.
But you just said that it doesn't work.
It doesn't, but I want to... I'm trying to prove the theorem. I'm trying to entertain.
I want
you to show. It doesn't work. Then I'll show what's to be done in order that this
is not to have it.
Right?
Sure. So you gave us the wrong hypothesis.
I said try. I should pull to the quotation of the question. So that's the result.
This is also an exercise.
Yeah, and I'll give you a comment. I will then prove it.
Oh, okay.
But differently.
That's number four.
Yeah, these are numbers. Two coefficients equal minus 4.
This is the correct.
I hope so. So, my understanding that at least some people here.
Delta prime means the derivative with respect to z or w?
Which? This?
Yeah.
Now, that's the same. I tend to forget. Maybe Peter will help me. People write like that what they really mean. But they write,
usually they said to W.
Usually
to
W.
So I think. I think it's W. There may be some mistakes in my format. I apologize. It's an exercise anyway, so it's a matter of science. So my understanding that many people don't know if techniques to computing brackets like that. And if so, this is a rather painful computation. So many people, I'm assuming, don't know the Wick theorem, and probably Victor will explain what that is. And then you will appreciate how effective it is. So the kind of scientific advanced way to compute this, of course, you use the compute the operator product expansion.
The second term is y of w times y of w
prime,
meaning.
So different.
It is prime?
Hmm? No, prime.
No, before the.
That's prime.
This is
y prime. Everything is normally O.
Yeah, but here it doesn't matter much because
because
the y commutes for itself. And let me skip something as W because in the presence of y, that's clear what I keep in mind. So you do the OP. And then the rules of the game are, you see which field, you look at what fields, now non-trivially, brackets, and out with what field. So you will have twice D of the hitting one, either one or another W, and likewise this D hitting one or that, or doing it twice. If you do it twice, you will have double contraction, and that will give you.
Yeah, for three fields, of course, you don't need the general form, you can use the track.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course, of course. So that would be what? So you do it twice, so there will be two possibilities here and two there. So four, and one will come with a minus. Because if del is on the right, then it will be a minus. So it will be minus four. Y of z, y of w. S to power 1, it is 0, and it is 0 for an important reason. It's, this part is a result of a classical computation. This is an informal statement, but that's another hint as to there being some geometry underlying. So I'm saying that this is like bracketing the. So this expression is more or less the same as if you can bracket it, the field with itself using the derivative. And that's true in general for any computation like this. So if you think about it, it will be like that. So therefore, anyway, you will get a zero. That's what I'm deciding at. So that's not quite an OP, so there will be two terms. One with a double probe, minus 4 pi w squared on g minus w. Plus, we can use the tail expansion. So another minus 4y of the W. Y of W prime. Now that's there, and that's the delta. And that of course immediately reconstructs the results of that exercise. The very object. Yeah, here it is. So that, of course. So if you know OP and the experiment, of course, what the exercise claims, that would be true. So what shall we do? There is a very simple way.
You want to replace normal and perfect way. Expression such as conservative, you just make the thing on the stuff.
Or I will simply write a formula, the formula that will give. So what Victor is saying, I hope I understood him correctly, is the normal ordering is a helpful thing, but it's an artificial operation. So the point here is that this expression is rather canonical, but up to some lower degree terms. We have a freedom here, and that's the main idea for what will follow soon. So having played with this, it's not hard to see that in fact, so in fact, the correct relation is so fourth x of t equals one on y of z and dx. And then if you compute like this, you can really see that things will work. So let me formulate. So at least the commutation relations are then preserved. But you write a couple more lines for this computation, you will get this. And that's what we wanted. So let me now formulate the result. I remind you that what I'm dealing with is two vertex of this. This and this. Now we are talking about global set. Global set. So this is no longer a sheet. We have to complete what it tells us. The standard beta gamma system itself that what the user calls gamma. Now with that, and it's inverted.
But can I ask a question?
Yeah.
The right hand side, there in this map, the x goes to, isn't it the same as saying that you take normally of the product, the other associate, the other term in the associate? You just take normally of the product of y with itself, normally or the product with v. I think it's the same thing. I mean, you can write this as, I'm asking a question. Is the right-hand side there equal to?
Right-hand side where? Here?
Yeah. Question. Is it equal to, right, whether to write, normally or the product?
Of what?
Of y with itself.
What do you mean? So you do from right to left and from left to right.
Exactly.
And then
the I think it's the same. Why don't you write down? Y, another y,
D,
D,
y.
But the order product, you take it in the other way. No, the other way. No, the other way.
No, that's...
You first do y.
Y with D.
No, that's what I'm doing. I'm always doing this.
Yeah, but yeah. I'm saying that the right-hand side there, I think, is
he
the same...
To add normally the product from left to right. This is from right to left. It's the same.
No, Anna. Just this other one. Just
this are saying that if I do it differently, I will have this.
You have exactly the same expression.
Yeah, that's right. But that's a coincidence. This is not going to be generalized. So my point of view is this is the degree 3 term is fundamental. What follows is. Can be varied. This is where.
So this is just a coincidence. It coincides
with. This is yeah, that's what
it coincides with y, y.
This is a coincidence. It's not going all with one.
But this can be extended because as a morph it extends.
Yeah, yeah, you can. In this particular case, you can use that. But I
simply
didn't
know
that. But yeah, you can.
So there are no general rules.
So what I will explain at some point is not only there aren't general rules, there can be. There, in principle, there cannot be any general rules. Sometimes this is plain impossible. That is the main result as far as this kind of thing goes. Sometimes it's plain impossible. And there is a very
abstraction.
Yes, there is an abstraction. It's a certain cohomological concept. We have these two things, and the lemma will say that we can define a funny isomorphism. An obvious would be f goes to f, but that's not what we want. So, yeah, the map, that sense, you know, the identity in my ring that plays the role of the vacuum vector to itself. X naught to 1 on y naught and dx minus 1 is what I wrote there, minus y naught square dy minus 1 minus 2 y minus 1. This minus 1 is the result of this state version of the differentiation that occurs in the field version. T of y naught is y minus. So this map extends in uniquely. That's item one. Item two is perhaps not so important, it's pleasing. So the mapping, of course you can do, you can swap x and y.
So is it kind of automorphism over the two? If you do it again, you get the idea, I suppose.
No.
I'm
talking about the opposite.
Yeah, I mean, if you switch letter.
Yeah, so there won't be any automorphism, you know, different from the identity, that's what I'm saying. So of course you can write a similar map, starting with, you know, y going 1 on x, is the inverse
to
this one. That perhaps is easier given one, that perhaps is easier to prove without computation. But on the other hand, people would like to practice in vortex algebras. And as at the beginning, this is, you know, this weather that came from physics. It's natural at the beginning at least to practice confusing concrete things. So it's a fun computation doing this and then replacing y with 1 on x, dy with whatever it is, and then you will have lots of non-associative normal orderings and see that in the end of the day, the result is 1. It's quite a computation.
But I suppose it's kind of obvious because...
Yeah, of course.
By extension theorem, because if you have a map on generating fields which preserve brackets, then by uniqueness extension theorem...
Yeah, I agree with you, but...
No.
When we were playing with this 70 years ago, at that time, you don't trust any kind of theorem, so you start computing, and the direct computation is extremely painful. I don't know how many years of my life I left getting it wrong again and again. In the end of the day, kind of converge. So it is true, it requires some, you know, faith to get it correct.
But why it follows from extension theorem?
Because if there is a map on generating fields which preserves all the upper brackets, then it extends.
But you need to show that D goes back to D after you do it twice. This is the computation you are saying.
Yes, this is.
No, so what is the lemma? This map extends to homomorphisms of F itself.
No, I'm talking about part two of the lemma. Part two is saying that it's of order two, essentially.
Yeah, but if composition of them is identical.
Exactly, this is what he's saying, that you need to check that the composition is identical.
On generating fields.
But to check that it's identity on generating fields is not obvious.
No, not all. Maybe it can be done again.
On X is clear. I mean, X goes to one way.
X goes to itself. Then
X goes to itself. But D goes to D.
More or less. Yeah. So if instead of computing you want to do some thinking, then it could be not that hard. But it's kind of a perverted fun to do it straightforward.
D goes to D is a computation.
For a beginner in unordered self.
Yeah, but also there are very few automorphisms.
I just want to point out that Victor has just proved that in one, so probably it saves me from the necessity of doing that. So item one really is, if you think about it, item one is a more or less direct consequence of the extension field.
Right.
Once the commutation duration has been verified. All right, so here is then the shift. Are there any questions? So what is it good for? Is it good for anything? All right, next time. So once these formulas, formula like this, or perhaps even better, a formula like this, and like this, have been written, formulas like that immediately start make a bell start ringing, at least for people of a certain kind. Does it remind you of anything? Of course, anybody from Victor, apart from Victor and Tomayut. That is the famous, the beginning of the famous Wokimoto realization. So let me explain this. I'm sure Victor mentioned if you have any simple layout, then there is a universal vertex algorithm actually. I'm only interested.
Yeah, it's called affine vertex.
Yes, affine. That's how it's called. Affine vertex.
Affine. Offset from level.
That's level
K. K put put K in the top.
You see it? Yeah. And it went up like so a fine vertex algebra. So as a space it looks briefly remind you. So this in particular, this is an SL2 hat module, and as such, it's simply an induced representation. So, or is it like this? No, I'm afraid it isn't. SL2 hat.
What's that?
Minus.
Or you can put this into T.
This is a more or less
also instead of secret, I use keep it.
So the role of this small k is that it's a trivial module over that algebra, the C, but K acts as identity.
K cap.
K capital acts as number K.
Oh, yeah. So to place those formulas in this context, I will quickly remind you what this looks like. So it's conformally graded about itself. The gradation in formula speaking given by the power of T. So reading at, so that's conformal weight 0. Conformal weight 1 is essentially SL2. So T inverse like 1 F, T inverse and H. And so it goes, and whatever element x of SL2 there is, the corresponding field, of course, is some x t to the n. So these formulas were discovered by Wakimoto in a different, pleasingly different but similar context. So he wasn't thinking about geometry or anything like this. He was trying to find, you know, Virasoro algebra is famous for having a nice three-field realization. Three-field realization means being having a homomorphism into a vertex algebra of three fields, such as this fermion vortex algebra or something like this. And so in my notation, of course that wasn't the notation that Wakimoto used, but in my notation, that is exactly what Wakimoto discovered. That there is a map from a fine vortex algebra at a very special famous level, which is minus 2, or SL2. And these are essentially different. I could make my signs are not 100% verified, but the gist of the formula is, again, at the level of fields, E of Z goes to, I think, minus DZ, not terribly safe, or plus, we will see. That's probably not that part of that. H of Z goes to minus Y of Z. You know, I should be probably using X as my preferred coordinate, since that is provided. EHF. again, that was his discovery, that his, I don't know, that perhaps how, I don't know exactly how he arrived at those formulas, but perhaps in view with what I told you today, that the train of thought was this. If you forget about Z, these are SL2 generators. SL2 acts on CP1. In the coordinate on the big cell, the formulas are more or less up to sign this. E goes to DDX, H goes to plus also, minus.
You should put more models.
X, DX, and F goes to plus minus X squared DX. And let them introduce Z, consider fields, and put the normal order to make sense out of
it.
I forgot normal ordering for no reason, but I forgot this for a reason. So I guess that was his train of thought, try these fields. I take the same train of thought, so, and this doesn't work, and then he discovered the collection. So if it's a closet, seems to be more or less perfect.
But that correction term then only works for case 1.
No, case minus 2.
Because 2 is a group of two numbers.
At least in this notation, k is, so my notation is OPE is, well, it's, I haven't defined the K, by the way, but how K actually enters this formula. But if you do it in a standard way, that's what you will get. So an immediate consequence of this formula is that, so by definition, that embeds, it's kind of a, what I'm about to write is a tautology. This sends, well, that's what I read below. Rather, this is an embedding of, you asked me about the level. So this is an embedding of this algebra into the space of sections of my sheet.
This is right, this embedding.
It's not a, it is a same embedding, it's just a homomorphism. It's a homomorphism. So, but an immediate consequence of the computation I did above is that, you know, this is a space of sections on the big set. By the very definition, it contains the space of global sections. And an immediate consequence of what I said is that this whole thing actually belongs, so this map factors through the space of global sections. But that's simply because in my computation, this field is the image of, if you go over to a different chart, you will get this.
With rather dx, global section is a sub-algebra.
Yes. Of course, so you just have sections on a, on an open set, and some of them can be extended to global sections, and some cannot.
But why it doesn't be minus four C open set?
Why this? This I'm trying, this I started explaining. It's because these are all sections on one cell, so will, can they be extended to sections on another cell? So you change the variables and see what happens, but we have already done that. I have erased this, but that's what my previous lemma said, that for example, this field upon the change of coordinates will go to to win of that field. It's rather dy, and that will go to plus minus d sub x on a different chart. D goes to plus minus y squared d plus 2 x times, and the other way around. So this field will go to that, and likewise this will go to this.
So the coordinate change exchanges E and F.
Yeah, you exchange E and F, something like that.
That's the result of the... Doesn't quite. It's just saying that on a different chart, they will be swapped.
So it's kind of automorphism.
It's model. It models. So if on one chart you define it by this formula, then on another chart, the formula will be the result of this automorphism that swaps E and F.
And H goes to minus H.
H goes to minus H. But this is not important to me. What's important is that if you change variables, and that the conduct of the previous lambda is that change of variables. If you do that, these two expressions, the first and the last, will go to similar expressions in a different variable. Hence, they define a global variable. That this field will be preserved. It's an automatic because this field is related to the commutator of these, etc.
So we have harmony, so get this out of this input to Cairo different over the vectors on C.
Yes.
And then you're saying that if you take global section on the whole CP1, of course it invades. But also you say
I'm saying that the image it actually belongs to global section. That's what I'm saying.
Yes, the image was
in the space of global
and you're
section.
Saying this goes from this point.
It's just the content of my lemma. Do you want me to write it? I thought this is
all this. Therefore, there is a map from ground, from bottom to the vertex algebra. It's again probably not involving.
No, there is no such map. In fact, there is a kernel. It's a different matter. I'm simply saying that the image of this vertex algebra, which by definition is here, actually belongs to the global set. For the reason
so
that
this inclusion should be erased, let's say.
Oh, this is
no, no, it's the left one. There is this kind of inclusion sign. From bottom to SF2, there is this.
Oh, no,
it's
no,
no,
there is nothing.
Oh, that's an arrow. It's an arrow.
Ah, it's an arrow. Ah.
It's a dashed arrow. This is something whose existence is not obvious. But the content of my example is here. Sections that extend or can be extended to global sections. For example, E of Z goes to B sub Y of Z by the previous lemma. In fact, by definition, that was used. And then the previous lemma computes this image to the effect that it equals minus x of z squared x of z minus 2 x of z prime. So the reason that the center is, the level rather, is critical is as follows. Another computation will show that this field, all of this is not really ordered, goes to zero and then of course is another remarkable well, in view of Bakimoto, this is all of course known, but if you haven't seen it, this is quite remarkable, and this fact has various interpretations. For one thing, coming back to what I explained from about the classical localization of D modules, this is an analog of a computation that we discussed for usual under the map of SL2 vector fields on CP1. Rather universal envelope to differential operators. This central element went to zero. It's a rather fundamental observation. So now this thing goes to zero. That, of course, can be without any reason. You see, if it goes to zero, then the algebra can be simple, so it should have an ideal.
Should it be a 2h, h squared? Yes.
Of course. There should be something special about this element. And of course, it's a famous fact that it is precisely when k is minus 2 that typically the center of this algebra is k. But if k is minus 2, then the algebra is not simple. Perhaps it's best to put it this way. And it is not as simple for a specific reason. If k is minus 2, the famous family of elements, let me write it, T sub n, if I denote, I'm not sure it's good notation, let me write it that sub. Let me denote it by C. So this is field attached to the S mu. So something like this. They are all such elements.
This stands for Sugawara.
Yeah, yeah, it's Sugawara, and they, so to speak, belong to the center. So, is there a notion of the center of a vertex cell? Can I write it like this? What I want to say is that S n commutes with any commutes with any element of
what is C
of the Lie algebra tends with infinite sum, so it's kind of a something
yeah,
belong to the center of the vertex algebra.
You can write just that S of C commutes with X X of C X of M.
Yeah. And so this, as much as it becomes reduced, and you can introduce, let me spend a few more minutes, I'll formulate the result, and then we'll make it. So we can consider the quotient. We take this finite object algebra and the quotient by the image of those sotovars. In principle, you attempted to write, to use all possible values. It's definitely possible that if you give this effect, you will realize at once that s minus 1, s 0, etc., s 1, etc., all these restricted to b minus 2 or something. Are zero automatically. But the rest, s minus 2, s minus 3, etc., isn't. You can quotient out, it still works itself. Hence, an SL2 hat module. In fact, what I'm saying is that now it is actually simple. Hence my notation. So this is, in fact, a simple. And the simple vertical. The fact is true, as far as I understand, for an arbitrary G, and it's a rather non-trivial result, proved relatively recently by Frankel and Gates, glory, but the SL2 case is much simpler, and that was known many years ago. Whatever I'm at, I promise you to formulate the result and make a break. So, when you give this whole thing a thought, you will realize now that, you will realize that we have a map. We've got a map. From this thing to the space of global centers. Immediately questions arise. I should have asked, there, the map of the corresponding B, is this an embedding? Is this an isomorphic? No, it has a curve. Here is a better map. Is this an embedding? Is it injective? Is it subjective? The answer is yes. And more than that, since we are dealing with a shift, in addition to the space of global sections, which is the zero homology, and the space of the first homology. So here is the lemma that I'll explain it, rather prove after the break. So both H naught and H one are isomorphic. Then this is really difficult. Vertex algebra. Well, this is the shift of vertex algebra. So H naught is canonically a vertex algebra. So this first isomorphic of H naught with this is an isomorphic of vertex algebra. As to H1, it's only a module over H naught. But as a module, it's, so a vertex algebra is a module over itself. So H1 is isomorphic to this vertex algebra regarded as a module over itself. I will explain this. by the way, of course, this theorem is an analog of the statement that I proved from the first time doing some localization. Namely, remember, the universal envelope in a view of G, mod out the zero central charge, was going to be isomorph to the space of global centers. So to infect. That's what I discussed. Of course, this is a straightforward analog you replace associated vectors with a vertex algebra. The funny thing, perhaps something that makes this story attractive, is that instead of a zero central charge, you get a shift. Well, it should be minus integral. So this is an analogy, but then there is a striking discrepancy, which is kind of quite fundamental. Here, I didn't formulate this as a theorem, but I actually used this fact. The higher cohomology of this shift is actually zero, and this is a part of their, important part of their localization scheme. In their language, it's a consequence of the fact that CP1, or in fact any flat manifold, is, as they say, D-affine. So higher cohomology of any shift vanish. So this is a fundamental difference. It doesn't in this case. Here, the first cohomology is non-zero. I will prove this lemma, and not so much because I find the proof, but I find the lemma very important. Perhaps it has some importance. But the proof itself will reveal something very important about the shift, and this is something I will be trying to generalize later. So I will give the proof as an excuse to talk a little more about the shift I construct. So first of all, there will be certain things that I won't be able to just remind you of some facts. Facts mainly come from representation theory of the head, which I don't have, of course, any time to explain. So, first of all, this working out module which in my notation is the space of global sections on the big cell. Its structure is completely known. It has a unique irreducible SL2-hat, I mean, submodule. Another thing that I will have to use is the notion of the formal character. So whenever I will have something graded, doesn't have anything to do with the representation theory, but whenever I have a graded vector space, I will consider its character a formal power series with the dimensions of the graded components of coefficient. Well, of course, I assume that they are a finite dimension. And this irreducible SL2-hat module at the critical level has a known.
What is irreducible? That it is not irreducible. It's a unique irreducible subnet.
We came out of the but this is by definition that the notation for the irreducible is the general notation, isn't it? Not lambda. L lambda k. It's a standard notation for the irreducible g hat module. That's just the.
No, we don't know. You prove the general that L0 minus 2 is a subordinate to gap.
The other way around. L0 minus 2 is the irreducible highest weight and zero.
And this is a multiple gamma CP1.
This is what I want to prove. L0 minus 2, it's a standard notation for the reducible highest weight module. I want to prove that it is isomorphic for the space of global set. So I
can. Ah, it's the CP1 on C, no?
Yeah, CP1 on C.
Ah,
the
yeah.
Space of sets, my, as I said, is my final notation.
Ah, okay, it's L0 minus 2, the reduction by taking global set.
In anyway, it's the form of character is known. Here is a very simple formula. It's an all right, so that's a remainder on representation theory. Now, part of the lemma is there for immediately proven for the space of global section.
And this is simple sub-mode or is generated by space behavior?
Yes. If it's unique, then what else can I do? So my space of global sections is part, of course, of the looking of the module. And the proper part. For example, this thing has it's not and it's not doesn't belong to the space of global set. In my book, it doesn't. I mostly wrote why for some reason. So why not is not there. Just because if you write this in terms of x, you will get one and x not. And that's singular. So has, so to say, well, yeah, infinity. So this part is very simple. How about H1? We get handle on H1. Using some geometry. And the argument needed is what I wanted.
Well, you can give you proof the part the same page zero.
Yes. It's free. H naught is part of the Wakimoto. It's
okay.
A non-trivial part of the Wakimoto module.
Okay.
And it's an SL2 hat module. Wakimoto module contains a unique.
Ah, because it has a unique
reduced. Yeah, it's just if you quotient it out, the result is again in a reduced module. This is known.
Ah, so not only it has a unique reduced submodule, but factor by it is again a reduced.
Yes.
So you need this factor.
So how about, well, just amazing.
Better to say that the maximum submodule is a reduced.
Yes. I will compute to get handle on H1. I will compute its character. If it's the same, then it has. Then, by what I told you, it's automatically an irreducible representation. The irreducible representation, there is only No, there's no, well, it's really just for the representation, but I played with it. How can we do that? Well, we will use some geometry. I hope I wanted to say our characteristic of these huge shapes. It's better to use our character. So let me quickly remind you what is it that I mean. So in principle, if we have a shift on a vector space, on figure one, you can consider it a characteristic. And that's the automatic sum of dimensions of the commodity. But of course, so this has to make sense. So of course the dimension should be finite and the number of cohomologies should be finite, and this is all definitely makes sense if my E is a coherent shift of all X modules, all CP1 modules. Can this be applied to the shift in question? So imagine there being only H0 and H1. Then the other character would be CH0 minus CH1. CH0 we know. And if we find an alternative way to compute the other character, then the answer minus CH0 will give me CH1, and we will be done. So that's the plan. But this doesn't work immediately. And at first, and that this observation is why I started talking about it. The observation is that my shift of Carroll differential, my CDO is not even an seeing this a bit of a contradiction, because at the very beginning we thought of it as if it were, although we never used seriously this assumption, but that was part of our thinking. So for example, now it is. So the space of sections contains X0 and then the bunch of Xn's and Pn's. But we thought of this as C of X0 module, and it is. This algebra is a polynomial thing, so it's a ring over C of X0. But this obvious C X0 module structure has no vertex, or has no vertex or invariant, we may change the variables, or invariant meaning. Let me briefly explain why. Of course, if you have, I don't know, some p, an element, a polynomial in all those variables, then you can think of X0 operating on what? Multiplication. But this operation uses the fact that we have a fixed coordinate. And it quickly is a ruin if we change variables. So the only way to make sense out of this is they use the vertex algebra multiplication, which is preserved under the changes of variables. So you want to think of this as x naught operation number minus 1, p. This doesn't have any invariant meaning, but this does. But if you write it like this, then the module structure is gone. The associativity is ruined. For example, if you write x naught squared minus 1 applied to p, then one of the famous, actually the normal ordering rule, I guess Victor hasn't explained this, but I suspect will. So minus 1 of the square of the self-commuting field, for any field that square of any field, looks like this. There is the correct self-shift term. But then there is a bunch of, so to say, corrections. Actually, since they commute, so there will be twice as many such terms. The next will be x naught minus 3, x naught 1, etc. So were this equal to this, that would give me associativity. And this is all that ruins associativity. So there is no obvious way to define the OX module structure on this shape. You can say, well, why not try doing that? Instead, I will show you a fundamental and very easy to describe structure. So this is not a shape of OX module, but it has a filtration. Such that the corresponding graded object is an LCP1 module. And in fact, I'll mention parenthetically, is a shape of vertex persona. So when Victor or Marika, I know they're trying, each trying to make another reach the stage first. So whenever either of them explains what a vertex persona algebra is, you may want to return and see that what I'm about to define indeed gives a vertex person algebra structure on the graded object. I don't want to give you a formula. Official definition. I'll show you a couple of examples and leave it for you to figure out it again. It's self-explanatory, as you will see, I hope. So, furthermore, I may have mentioned it, but probably not sure emphasized. The sheaf I defined is graded. It's not just a sheaf of vertex algebra, it's a sheaf of conformally graded vertex algebra. So the filtration, which I haven't yet defined, but we'll see in a second, the filtration respects the grading. And so conformally graded, say. If you, where do you put the conformal weight? Subindex.
I didn't talk about it.
You haven't yet. So you have to do it like this. So there is a grading. I will talk more about it later, but at the moment, so it's given essentially by subindex. I will put it informally. Like various letters, X, DX, things like that, they all come with indices. So that's that. So the grading is determined by the index of letters. It's an important thing. So M, so since the filtration preserves the grading, I have the graded object for each component. And this is not just an OX module, it's a coherent. That is to say, finitely generated OX module. All right, it takes time to write all of this, but the fact itself is very simple. I'll show you a couple of weights, and you, I'm sure, all doubts will be removed. I don't know how the chief was defined. It was X or Y not. I think of those as functions. I already mentioned it. I'm used to writing like this, but it looks the top, as far as the grading goes, it's the bottom. So
I don't, sorry, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
When you write DCHCP1, comma N, you mean the graded space?
Yeah, the graded component.
That's finite dimensional, right?
It's a sheaf.
It's a finite or
It's a finitely generated almost. On each open set. You will see it now, you will see it now. So, remember what I said, a letter and the index is the graded component. There was also D1, D0, but D0 kills the vacuum. So, at the bottom there is only X0. And of course, this has the meaning of functions. Because X0 simply goes to 1 on Y0. That's how functions. For what follows, everything else will be, as I discussed, modules all of this polynomial again, looking at what happens over a big cell, for example. So at level 1, there were 2, x minus 1 and d minus 1. D minus 1, its transformation law, was problematic. That's what my lectures are all about. But x minus 1 is obvious. Can you guess? So what's the meaning of x minus 1 as a section of some gamma? That, of course, is a 1-4. Why? Well, look. X naught goes to minus or plus 1 on y naught. X minus 1, by definition, is still x naught. My transformations respect the orthotropic structure, so this goes to t equals y naught, but t is a derivation, so you will have minus y, if you will, t of y naught divided by y minus t of y naught, by definition, that operator was defined at some point, and it's exactly y minus 1.
Minus. Y index. You mean T of 1 over 1?
Ah. Yes. So this is the definition. It's hidden in that lemma that refers to the reconstruction theorem, extension theorem. If you know where fields go, then you know where derivatives go, or things like that. So this is hidden there, and this is just the definition of T, to what you find as a certain derivation. That's exactly the formula. You will also see that this computation has nothing to do with this particular example. It doesn't take much imagination to see that if you work on a general variety and you have x and it goes to f of y, then of course t of x will go to t of f of y, and that will give you, of course, f prime of y dy. That's a one-dimensional, but a different arbitrary one-dimensional variety. If you introduce indices, you will write a similar formula. So I hope I convinced you that this is just a one form. And that makes sense when you write. S to d minus 1 here is, how to put it, the crux of the matter. Its transformation law is elaborate, but not too elaborate.
Wait a moment, so what's your point that what you talked about, what you call chiral differential operators, actually are chiral differential forms?
It's a combination. There will be forms and vector fields. It's a mess.
I contain both.
You will see.
I contain both vector fields.
Yeah, I've given you differential forms. You will now see a vector field. So it's both. So, what's the transformation law for this element? You think of this as a section of a bundle. Well, it was.
From the viewpoint of transformation law, so this is one transform differential form.
That will transform, not quite as a vector field, but something like that. It goes to its axis, so it will go to. So, I guess I should do it. That's d with respect to x, and the units is minus 1. It goes to, as we discussed, y naught squared or minus. No. So this thing, I insist, has no particular geometric meaning. But if you disregard it, then this is how the vector fields transform. And that's how we arrived at this formula. We kept the of this term. This term was the transformation law vector fields. Then correction was imposed upon this. The interpretation here is obvious. Here is the filtration I meant. So this whole thing is a rank 2 C electron module. It has a submodule generated by X1. And as such, it, in the shift, is a subshift isomorphic to 1 fold. D minus 1 generates a strange shift. Here is a finite transformation law. But if you close it, then, of course, that's the classic transformation law. So modulo of that, you will have vector fields. And that's the rule. X's with negative coefficients give rise to differential forms. Delts give rise to vector fields, but only if regarded as elements in a in an appropriate supercomponent. So the actual definition is rigorous, and I want to think that it suffices. It would suffice, I think, to consider the net level when you will see the path. So level 2. So we have, using indices, we have to get 2. You start with x minus 1 squared. So whatever I say about component 2 is an exercise. So x minus 1 squared by itself, without any corrections, transforms as the square of 1 fourth. By the way, of course, this is all these are line bounds, so rank 1 local vector shapes. So that's O minus 2, and that's level 2, as we discussed at some point. Next, so I start with x, that's the next. There goes x minus 2. x minus 3 is not quite omega 1, but it is modulo that. And I insist, omega 1, not omega 2. Differentiate twice and you will see. So if you quotient out all x's with negative, strictly negative indices, then these will have a chance of being a vector field. I think I should start with Dibon squared.
So again, x minus 2 are transformers 1 forms, modulo.
So the sum of indices is always preserved. So next, there goes x minus 1, d minus. Then d minus 1 squared. And then d minus. So the rules of the game are, if your filtration is correct, f gives you all address to d, whatever index is, o, there, where x, o minus 2, to d, o plus 2. If you multiply the this thing, decrease f, so this modulo that will give you o 0 plus 2. O, therefore, that will be o 4, and that will be o of 2. The filtration is this. And if you think a little bit about it, you will see that on these, on the corresponding graded space, so that abstraction, remember, f of x, g of x, minus 1, if you go over to the graded version, it will be this. The correction terms will all vanish. It's a simple computation. Correction terms, remember their, what their effect was. You will have at least one non-zero index. And non-zero index kills the d, so the number of d's goes down, and there you are. That's why it works.
So on the first levels you have differential forms of vector fields, and
here you have O 4 or O minus 4. So x gives you O minus 2, d gives you O plus. The products give you summation. So
no,
you
but how does it transform? Because we were easy like differential forms or like vector fields and all, but the last one.
That's a trigger. So you also have functions.
And the same for just functions. D minus 1 squared.
No. D minus 1 squared, that's all 4. D minus 1 is over 2. Ah, there are two of them. It's
there's one button.
Yeah. And again, people who know what the perfect Poisson algebra is will immediately.
Ah, simply omega 1. CP1 tensor space is just O minus 4. Right?
Yes. So it will go, and so as promised.
Just all of them is O of n. I think O of 1 are vector fields and O of.
O2 rather, vector fields, O minus 2 for instance. And there is linear combination of 2 and minus 2. All right, so. The proof practically is over, so I have a few minutes to go, so I'll just finish it, and then perhaps will be a nice.
So you have to compute the.
Yeah, and this gives me tools to do that. So I do. You notice that in this case, of course, this doesn't make sense. That's too big. But what does make sense is if your shift is a direct sum of shifts in various dimensions. I will in formula write it like this, u to the nth epsilon n. I simply in the nth component is epsilon n and its degree is n. That's a formal device. What I want to say is if you have an epsilon that's a direct sum of those, you divide its over character, not an over characteristic, to be a corresponding formal expression, sum over characters of the nth shift times u to the nth, formal power series. So, therefore, this perhaps doesn't make sense, but its over character does. Where I've been headed all along is that if you go from a shift, from a filtered shift to the graded shift, of course the cohomology change, but the over character doesn't. And therefore this is the same as this sum of over characters of the graded object. And there's, in view of what I did, well, it has to be extended. I want to skip the details. It's not very important. It's a simple combinatorial exercise. Do it at an arbitrary level. 7, 18, etc. If the other character of Om is, if I'm not terribly mistaken, 7 plus 1. So this itself is a very easy exercise. So, since we know the graded object as a linear combination of those, but then you compute it.
And what about n?
All n, not necessarily.
It is just n.
For example, if n is 0, that's the structure shift.
Yeah,
you will get 1, as we should. If n is 2, that's vector field. We discussed it. What? Something's wrong. Vector field, I should get 3. If minus is minus 1, and indeed differential forms have no global sections and only one dimensional first cohomology, so that's the problem. And if you use it and you think how what it looks like in, for all dimensions, you will get a nice formula like this. You will have a number of, you know, presentations of a number as a sum, something like this. It's not part. And this essentially completes our discussion. For now, I will write. Now we'll come back to where I start. The earlier character of my shift, on the other hand, is the formal character of H naught, which A now minus, the formal character of H1, which I don't. This was, you know, 1 and 1 minus u product of that type. This has just been computed to the effect that it simply such a problem. And so this therefore equals this minus what I would like to get.
That's to the power of minus.
That's a definition. Zero of the model, minus the first of the model. This has already been computed. Because that's an irreducible supercomputer.
Then asking is 2 or minus?
Minus. And so what we were after is this minus the battery is 1 minus 1 and 1 minus 2. That's I think of now this expression as you see. The other way around. I have to subtract this from this, otherwise I'll get the negative from a character. So 1 and 1 minus 3 minus 1. And so what I wanted to get is 2 times that infinite power. Well, that of course is the formal character of CH naught, the same as the formal character of this irreducible representation, except that it has got shifted, and this can be explained. So, but. You know, it's a phenomenon of critical level. A conformal weight is not a uniquely determined kind of at other levels, conformal weight is given by L naught, and you cannot shift it without violating. But here L naught is kind of zero, so you can get a natural module with shifted conformal weight, and there is a reason for that. So that's so H naught was generated by the constant function, that the generator of functions with H1, it starts with one form. And with one form, the generator is this Chern class. So the class of differential of the log of x. Or rather, in my notation, dx is, as you know, it's minus 1. And that indeed lives in dimension 1. So h1 is the same module, but generated by this, by the commutative class of this expression. So that's the proof of that lemma. And the main reason, as I said, to give it was to observe and utilize this a fixation and a shift like that. So next time I will try to generalize it. I will try to do the same on an arbitrary, starting with first for an arbitrary ring and then for an arbitrary variety. And the whole the flavor of the discussion will be like this. We will be having things with fixations. So.